A pleasure to be here, and I should tell you that Boris helped us very much when we started our institute in Dresden, because at the very beginning, do you know, everything was very incomplete and not very inviting and provisionally. And in a phase like that, you need support of good friends which start to get the thing moving. And Boris has helped very much by organizing a very excellent workshop. And when he did that, I think many people thought, well, place cannot be too bad if Boris is going there. So that helped us. And since then, he has been in close contact with our institute. And so it has visited us repeatedly. And more recently, he spent a longer period of time with the Martin Gutzwiller Fellowship. I should also mention that the same happened again when I was in charge of Asia Pacific Center for Theoretical Physics in Pohang in Korea, because there the problem was that one had to build up a respectable in-house research program, which wasn't there. And therefore, again, you have to try to attract people who and to interest them in the center and to attract with their activity other people. And Boris also organized there a very nice workshop and with his friends, some of them are here. And that was also very helpful for us. And at present, he's helping Sergei Flach very much to set up an institute for theoretical studies within the IBS in Korea. So Boris, thank you very much for everything, and best wishes for the future. Now I'd like to come to my talk. And the problem is we have had already three talks on this topic. Started with Leonid's talk on Monday, first talk at all, followed by a talk of Leo Kovenhoven, and also the talk given by Daniel Loss. So in today, the talk of Nigel Cooper also was in the same direction. So the question, what is left? So what I will try is to give a tutorial type of talk. But even then, I think some things are superfluous. Well, I leave out. So why are they of interest? I think we have heard this several times. I don't have to repeat it again. People want to learn more about or realize Majorana fermions because they are topologically protected objects. And what is important is you need superconductivity for that. What's important is that there are only very few intrinsic topological superfluids. Examples are the B phase of helium 3 and Cooper bismuth selenide. So in most cases, you will have to introduce superconductivity by proximity effect. Also, what you should keep in mind, there are always the two possibilities to search for these Majorana particles, either in a solid or in a system of ultra-cold atoms. And the parameters are the relations between parameters in these two systems are quite different. The three parameters are always the Fermi energy, the strength of spin-orbit coupling, and the Cooper binding energy. So in order to have a topological system, you need a non-zero Chern number. And also, just to recapitulate in 1 minute, so if you take any Bloch state and you change this Bloch state with respect to k and go on a closed path, then the final state and the initial state will be the same except for a phase. And that is the Berry phase, which can or cannot be zero or is not zero. And this phase is given by the derivative of with respect to k of your Bloch function. And it acts like a vector potential. So then if you convert this integral over the line in K-space, to an integral over S area, then instead of the vector potential, you have the curl of the vector potential. And then this integral is something like a flux, like magnetic flux. And if you identify this area over which you integrate with the Brillouin zone, then you will get a result which is zero or not zero. And if you do this for all the filled bands, then what you end up with, that is then the charm number. And that has to be zero in order to have a topological system. Now and then, if you have a topological system, you have also had several times, then you have the edge modes. And that makes a big difference whether topological system is time of Russell invariant or not. If it's not time of Russell invariant, like quantum Hall effect, you have edge chiral edge modes, and they are classified according to their number. And the corresponding object in the superconductor is again chiral modes, but these are Majorana fermions. And why? Because in that case, you have a particle hole symmetry, and therefore, when you look at the particle excitation and hole excitation, is the same state. So therefore, you have only half of the number of states in superconductors than in a topological, for example, topological insulator. And if the system is time reversal invariant, then the equivalent is the quantum spin Hall effect. And there, the edge modes appear in pairs of two. And the same correspondence you have in the superconductor, these are helical states. OK, and here it's said once more. We have heard this several times in the previous talk, so I can skip that. Here it just indicates that whether you have a particle or whether a hole, it's the same state. And therefore, you can have a state which is pinned to zero energy. We have also heard this morning in detail how you can generate superconductivity, for example, in a topological semiconductor or else, even in a metal you can do that, by proximity effect. And so that can be either in one dimension, where you then have the Majorana modes at the end of this one-dimensional system, or in two dimensions, then it will be a vortex. And this is done in order to have the vortex. You have to put a topological insulator on top of a magnetic insulator, which generates a magnetic field. And when you inject superconductivity into these surface states here of the topological insulators, then you will have edge states. But those edge states will now not run only along the edge of the probe, but also along the edge of such a the flux unit. And therefore, since the Majoranas always appear in pairs, you will have here one of the Majoranas is associated with the flux line, while the other is at the edge. That should be a vortex, not a vertex. Well, now I would really like to come to superconductors with Rajpa type spin orbital action. Now, if you have a single layer of lead deposited on a semiconductor, then this is still superconducting. And therefore, in this system, you have no longer inversion symmetry, because when you have this layer on the substrate, then the potentials on the two sides of the layer will be different. And therefore, you will have here an electric field set up. And then if you look into Landau-Lifschitz, what's the effect of an electric field? It causes spin orbit interaction. And this spin orbit interaction is then of this simple form indicated here. so the spin is now always perpendicular to the momentum. And everything is in the plane. And Z is the axis perpendicular to this, for example, lead layer. Then the, you will have two bands which touch each other in form of a Dirac cone. And there you see already what the whole thing will, the direction things are driven. If you have now a Fermi energy which is close to the cone, you may have a topological superconductor. So now these are two different surfaces which have different Fermi momentum, but the Fermi velocity is the same, both. But here in one case, the spins are running clockwise, they're always perpendicular to K, and the other counterclockwise. Now, if you have a superconductor of this type, then the question is, what type of pairing do you have? And you can have intra-band pairing, where you pair an electron here within one band, namely pair this electron with the one here with K and minus K. Or you can have inter-band pairing, where you pair an electron with K with this band, with minus K with this band. But if you analyze this, then you will find that intra-band pairing has equal spin singlet and triplet contributions, while inter-band pairing has only spin triplet contributions. Therefore, when you have a strong spin orbit coupling, or better, if you have a local, a purely local interaction, then only the intra-band pairing will be left. And assume now for a moment what would happen if the inter-band pairing would be the important pairing. So if you would have a particular type of interaction which favors inter-band pairing, so it could, in this particular case, not be a local interaction, then you would have to pair always an electron with K here and minus K here. But since the Fermi momenta here are different in the two cases, you see already that the spin-orbit interaction will have a sort of a pair-breaking effect. So spin-orbit interaction will break the pairs. And also, if spin-orbit interaction is sufficiently small, so that the pairs are not all broken, then if if spin-orbit induction is increasing in strength, you will eventually shift to a situation where you have a finite pairing momentum, because you have now pairing between unbalanced populations. So then there will be degeneracy with respect to the pairing momentum, and that is a situation which very recently has been investigated by Yuri Ovchinnikov. Now, I will come back to this later, because if you have a very strong magnetic field, then it turns out that situation is changed. Then even in, for local interaction, you will have the interband pairing will be the important one and not the intraband pairing. So now one question is, what happens if for example, if you have such a low concentration, low Fermi energy that you're in this regime, would this change, for example, topological charm number or anything like that? Because I also should have mentioned that in this case here, this is not a topological system. If you only look at this case here, there's a charm number different from zero. But here in this case, you have also charm number by opposite sign. So they cancel each other. So this is a topologically trivial situation. Now the same holds true for this case here, because if you look at this, we have here this filled region with the electrons. So here, outside here, you have one charm number, and here you have another which just cancels this one. So it's topologically trivial. Now, so let us assume that we have a large spin orbit scattering, so that we have only intra-band pairing. Then, as I have already mentioned before, a gap will open, as here. This Dirac cone will be split. And if we have then Fermi energy or chemical potential which is within this situation here, then you have a topological superconductor. Because now you got rid of spin degrees of freedom, and you pair this electron with that, so it's like you pair spinless fermions. So this is a situation people hope that they can realize that with ultra-cold atoms, and there are now considerable activities in this respect. Okay, so the other could skip here. Now this is just once more in pictures what I've said before, so I can go over that. This we have seen in the talk given by Leonid. Can go over that. So one problem is, see, if you apply a magnetic field perpendicular to the surface, that it has also a destructive effect on superconductivity, because you will have because of vortices, and that will, the orbital effect of magnetic field will destroy superconductivity. So what you really would like to have, you would like to generate a topological superconductor by applying a field which is within the plane. Now this is possible, as has been pointed out by Alessia, for very specific cases. If you have a semiconductor of the Forsyth structure, which is grown in 1-1-0 direction, as pointed out in the talk by Kuhn and Hoven, and if you have at the same time Raspar and Dresselhaus spin orbit interaction, then you can generate a gap by applying a magnetic field parallel to the plane in this particular case. And this has been proven by Alessia. It can be seen that this is true by looking at a very special case, namely when you have here Raspar spin orbit interaction, and you have here an anisotropic Raspar parameter. And if you assume that one of them is zero, but that the remaining one is equal to the interaction parameter of Dresselhaus, see here in this particular case, the Dresselhaus spin orbit interaction tries to align the spins perpendicular to the plane, while the Raspar spin orbit interaction tries to align the spins within the plane. And this competition then enables a situation where you can really open a gap by applying a magnetic field within the 1-1-1 plane, 1-1-0 plane. Now this brings me to the special feature of applying magnetic fields within the plane. And we are dealing with a situation that we have here these two different circles, so to speak, two-dimensional case, with clockwise and counterclockwise spins with respect to k. Now, when we apply a magnetic field parallel to the plane, then, for example, a field is applied in this direction, then these states are favored. They have a lower energy than the states at this end. Therefore, we would like to fill those states here, which implies that we shift the whole circle perpendicular to the direction of the field. Here, on this surface, just the opposite happens. Here, these states are favored, while those have a higher energy. Therefore, we would like to shift the states again perpendicular to the magnetic field, but in the opposite direction to here. Now, what happens if we have intra-band pairing? So if we have intra-band pairing with pairing momentum zero, then we pair here the electron here with k, and then with respect to the old origin, n minus k. And here the same. So this will be OK if the field is sufficiently small. But if the field gets larger, then it's more advantageous to shift the pairing together with the shift of the circle. In other words, we would like to pair electrons in the new rest frame, so to speak, with the opposite momenta. So that is that pairing now, the Cooper pairs now acquire a finite pairing momentum. Now, because here and here we have then the same pairing momentum, this gets very disadvantageous for this case. Because here in this case, we would like to pair the electrons if we also shift them with the origin of the system. So we would like to have a pairing momentum with minus q over 2. So, but this is, if we would do that, then we would lose a lot of phase space for the interband pairing. So what happened then in this case is that at a given size of the field, the pairing momentum shifts from zero pairing momentum to finite pairing momentum. And at the same time, we have here unpaired states, because here it is much better to move the electrons due to the magnetic field according to their favorable spin direction to move them like this and leave the states on the opposite side as unpaired. So here we have then as empty. So here we have unpaired electrons, and this will go on and on until with increasing field, this whole thing becomes unpaired. Now, when we have, so eventually we expect then there will be a second phase transition. So now what will happen in this particular regime when you have partially unpaired electrons? You will have then a spin current flowing. So you will have a ground state of the system with a finite spin current. So the electrical current, of course, has to be zero. There cannot be no charge current according to Bloch's theorem, but there will be a spin current. So the spin current will flow in the direction perpendicular to the field, and the direction of the magnetization will be parallel to the field. So how can we understand that we will have here a ground state with a finite spin current? Now this, in order to see this, you have to consider that a magnetic field acting on a superconductor has always two effects. One is on the orbits, and the other is on the spin. So we know if we can neglect the field effect on the on the spins, so if you only consider the effect on the orbits, then if the field is sufficiently high, we will have, at least in a type 2 superconductor, we will have an inhomogeneous solution, namely the upper crust of vortices. And in that case, we have screening currents around all the vortices. So we have a system where we have an charge current around the vortices and the screening currents. Now here, we have a situation where we have neglected the orbital effect and have just looked at the effect on the spins. Because if you have just a single lead layer with a parallel field, there is no space for any orbital effects. So therefore, here we have again, in analogy to the upper crust of vortices, we have again here an inhomogeneous superconducting state. But instead of an electric current, we have a spin current. So that's the reason. So then how would one be able to detect such a situation that we have partially de-pairing? Now, for example, you would see this in the tunneling density of states for this two-dimensional system. So here in this particular case, these are numerical results for a given value of alpha, where this finite pairing momentum starts to set in, you will would then see filling of the gap and quite big changes in the tunneling density of states. Now, what is expected is if the fields get larger, even larger, so in the limit of a very large field, of the order of the spin orbit in action, then we expect there should be a second phase transition. Namely, eventually we expect that we will have then for one circle pairing with pairing momentum Q, 2Q, while for the other spin direction we expect pairing momentum minus 2Q. So they should be equal but opposite. So, but the details of this phase transition have not been really worked out, but this is now done in, numerically and for different parameter regimes. So it's something which is worthwhile to check. Now, then the question is what happens if you have two magnetic fields, one perpendicular, as we have said before, and one parallel. In that case, then you will have the splitting of the two different Fermi surfaces, as pointed out before, but now with a finite pairing momentum, because now here, if you look at this, so if you're here in between this gap with your Fermi energy, then K, if you pair an electron from here and here, this does not correspond anymore to K and minus K, because of this distortion of these circles by the field in the plane, as I pointed out to you before. So from the very beginning, you have here finite, as you apply a field perpendicular to the plane in addition to the one, I'm sorry, by applying a field parallel to the plane in addition to the field which is perpendicular to the plane. You will have right away the finite Cooper pairs with finite Q, and you will have then a topological inhomogeneous superconductive state. Okay, so then the last question is, what happens if you have here the situation where the field perpendicular to the plane is opening the gap here, and the other field is now tilting the two minima which you have, this is now the field in the plane, and if the concentration is so low that you are here, then again you here you have gotten rid of spin degrees of freedom, so it will be here pairing of a polarized system, and it will be a topological system, but without spin current. So this is a brief summary of what I wanted to say, and so the conclusions are that that it's worthwhile to study more these ultra-thin superconducting layers, and also, of course, to study the ultra-cold atoms on optical lattices. And it seems that there are still quite a number of interesting features which have not been really fully exploited and might lead to interesting new physics. So thank you very much.